I was turning 40 and I was kind of tired of writing nonfiction and I wanted to change. And I actually tried to get a job, like a real, I was freelancing. So that didn't, I went to two interviews and I went, there's no way I'm working for somebody else. So I thought I would try to write a novel as a challenge to me as a writer. Cause I knew how to write these guidebooks, which I continued to do. And I knew how to write articles, which I continued to do, and columns. That's another whole category of nonfiction writing that I really enjoy, we can talk about. But I decided, okay, I'm gonna try something really nuts and write a novel. And the rabbi who I had talked to about my wedding, whose name is Larry Kushner, Lawrence Kushner, has written many books, introduced me to the idea of Midrash in Judaism, which is the imaginative literature of Judaism, which is really wild. There's the law, there's halacha, and then there's Midrash. And Midrash is the storytelling. And it gives you enormous permission to take liberties with the biblical text. So I thought I would see if I could write a novel based on some biblical story. And I started with Rachel and Leah, who are the wives of Jacob, which is a pretty well-known story. And I thought that's what I would write the story about, but I didn't see the plot there. I needed a plot, actually. And as I read through that part of Genesis, you get to the story of Dinah, who's the only recorded daughter of Leah, and the story of what happens to her in her life when she goes out into the city of Shechem and I think falls in love, and her beloved goes to her father and asks for her hand in marriage. Her older brothers are not happy about this for a number of reasons, and there is a massacre as a result of this marriage. And then she disappears from the biblical text, and she's gone. So I decided I would write her story. She doesn't have a single line in it. There are very few lines given to women in the Hebrew or the Christian Bible. And I thought her silence was eloquent, so I decided I would try to write a novel from her point of view. And while the story of Dinah is often called The Rape of Dinah, the book became, almost from the beginning, it was first person. Really, it's the process of rewriting where I discover or where I shape a voice. The challenge with The Red Tent was to write something that's not contemporary vernacular, but isn't stilted. It's not thee and thou, it's not biblical, it's not the King James, nor is it a translation of the Bible. I mean, it's a improvisation on the Bible. It's not a novelization of the Bible. It leaves the text, it retells the text. It continues your story when there is no story in the text. And I feel I had permission to do that as an American writer and who I am, and also as a Jew, I'm delighted when I hear that rabbis use this as an introduction to Judaism classes to demonstrate the way that Jews wrestle with text and mess around with text, actually. And that's not sacrilegious, actually. So the hard part of writing that book was trying to figure out what language I could use and what language I couldn't use. So an example of that, and I have a few writing partners, writing group, who I've known for years. And at one point I used the word hell, and one of them said, did they have hell? Did that work? And I realized that while they may have had, there was some concept, but to use the word hell wouldn't work because it's such a specific reference in English that I got rid of that word. And there's, if I go back and look at it, which I don't, I find words that I think, oh, I wouldn't use that word. I think the word petite shows up someplace and then I went, oh God, that doesn't belong there. But so it's the rewriting where I find and differentiate and, you know, realize that voices need to be a little bit different. I think probably the voices in The Red Tent are not as differentiated, partially because it is a little bit elevated and differentiated from contemporary speech. The closer you are to now, I think it's more and more important that you make clear who's speaking, because not everybody talks the same way. And we know that would hit your ear weird, but because this is so far into the past and because it does, it's a different universe, different world, different language, The word choices were really complicated, and also not to make references that would have been historically inaccurate. It wasn't my title. It was my editor's title, actually. The Red Tent is the place where women would repair to during their menstrual cycle and when they were giving birth and after giving birth for a period of time to recuperate, and also during illness. And those kinds of places have traditionally been seen as places of banishment and pollution, but that's not how I wrote it. And we'll get to menstruation later, but it was a place of rest, repair, and sharing of stories. It was a women's space. It was also the way I imagined it was in the center of things. So it wasn't it wasn't a secret. So all the men knew what was going on, and it wasn't polluting. It was still part of the community. So that's where things do happen in the Red Tent. That's not only the only place where things happen. When I was writing the book, my file names on my computer were the Book of Dina. And the editor at St. Martin's, the wonderful Bob Wyatt, looked up, I think on Amazon, and how many books started the Book of, and there were like 500 books that started with that. And he came up with the Red Tent. And it took me a little while to come around to it, but it does seem obvious. What else would it be? But he's the one who named it that. Well, it was published to deafening silence. There were really no reviews, and actually Bob left the publishing company, and it was not clear it would even get into paperback. So it had a for a first novel, it had a very modest but not disastrous print run. But I had heard about, actually my rabbi somebody had sent him a novel, who a friend of his, and he liked it, he mentioned it, he passed it on. And I have rabbi friends because I write books about Jewish life. And so I asked the president of the Women's Rabbinic Network, which was the Reform Women's Jewish Rabbis, and my friend who was the president of the Reconstructionist Rabbis, if they would read it, if they would recommend it. And we would send copies to people on their list, they would send copies. And this was a way of keeping the book alive. Also, I went to book groups. I would go to anything. I would, you know, locally, nobody heard of this, so nobody knew anything about it. So that it became a word of mouth bestseller that way, and independent bookstore owners liked it and featured it, and they sold it. I mean, they really sold it, and it was on the indie book list bestseller list way before it ever was on the New York Times bestseller list. So that's one of those examples of the importance of independent bookstores and the relationship readers have with independent bookstores. People go in and say, you know me, what do I want? What do I like? And they said, I think you would like this. So that's how it stayed alive, and then it got into paperback, and then it really became a book group. In paperback, of course, it really became a book group favorite. And that's super high praise, because that means that it's engaging enough for people to want to talk about it, and people recommend, book group readers recommend their books to other book group readers, and it doesn't matter how many questions they put at the back of a book or how publishers advertise books. Book groups are really a word of mouth, kind of pure in some ways, way of selling books. It's like, I love this book, here, you read this book, you'll like it too. It's readers saying, I think you'll like this. One of the big surprises for me when it came out, after it was in paperback and I started getting invited to places, was I remember being at a bookstore in Connecticut, and there was a grandmother, a mother, and a daughter who came up to sign books. And it didn't occur to me that it was an intergenerational kind of book. And it has proven to be so over time, but I was so delighted and pleased about that.